So a major factor that drives our weather is air pressure. Air pressure is pressure caused by the weight of the air in the Earth's atmosphere.
All right, you've heard Mrs. Ostrowski talking about air pressure as being the weight of the air above you being stacked on top of you. And maybe you're sitting there thinking about, wait, does air weigh that much? Well, yes. And the answer has got to be yes. Air has mass. And I'm going to show that to you in just a minute. Air has mass, and because it has mass, it's going to weigh something. Here's an example. I have a balloon sitting on a scale. We're going to take a look at how much mass that has. So the balloon has a mass of 3.0 grams. So I'm going to blow up that balloon. There. Same balloon on the scale. The only difference is I've added some air. And now let's take a look. Same balloon, same scale, but now the mass is 3.4 grams. That means that I put 4.4 grams of air into this balloon. Now, that might not seem like a lot, but if you stack a balloon's worth of air on top of me, and then another balloon's worth of air, and another balloon's worth of air, and keep doing that for 60 miles, that's how far up the air goes above me. I've got 60 miles of air stacked on top of me right now. That's a lot of mass, and that mass has weight, and it pushes down and becomes the air pressure.
Next, we're going to talk about what factors actually go into influencing air pressure. There's pretty much two ways that you can look at air pressure. You can look at air pressure as a function of altitude, or in terms of how far you are above sea level, and you can look at air pressure as a function of the temperature and humidity of an air mass. So let's start with altitude. Here's a view of our school. As you know, our school has three floors. We have the first floor, where you have sixth graders, the second floor, where you mainly have seventh graders, and the third floor, where you mainly have eighth graders. Back when you were a sixth grader, you were on the first floor, and you had a lot of pressure on you being in a new school, but also the fact that you literally had more air above you than the other floors, because you have the weight of the air from above, including the second floor and the third floor of the school. As a seventh grader, you literally have less pressure on you. Not only do you know your way around the school, but you literally have less air above you because you are now on the second floor. So there is less air pushing down on you. Next year, as an eighth grader, you will be on the third floor. You're going to be higher in altitude, which means you have less air pushing down on you compared to sixth grade and seventh grade. So you are experiencing the least air pressure in the building when you are an eighth grader. Now let's take a look at air pressure as a function of air masses, specific humidity, and temperature. Let's say we have an air mass at 65 degrees Fahrenheit, and we have another air mass that is 73 degrees Fahrenheit. The air mass at 65 degrees is relatively denser than the air mass at 73 degrees. Notice how the 73 degree air mass has particles that have higher energy and are more spread out, therefore less dense. The 65 degree air mass, as a result, because it is more dense, will sink down in a downdraft, while the air mass that is 73 degrees Fahrenheit will float up as an updraft. Because the air mass is a downdraft, it's literally pushing down on you, and this results in high pressure. Versus the air mass that is an updraft is lifting up off of a person, and therefore this is low pressure. So as you can see, altitude does influence air pressure, but the temperature of the air mass, and as you will eventually learn, the humidity, will also influence air pressure. Low pressure, as you will see when we do more weather maps, is an area on the weather map of warmer, lifting, and unstable air, which is associated with storms. In contrast, there's high pressure, which is an area on a weather map with colder, sinking, stable air that is associated with clear, pleasant weather. We can represent air pressure on what we call an isobar map. In an isobar map, lines on the map are connected to show areas of the same pressure. It is worth noting in an isobar map that the air pressures only take into account the temperature and humidity of that particular part of the map. It does not account for altitude. Rather, the air pressures that you see on this map were mathematically corrected to have it be as if the United States was all the same altitude above sea level. Lastly, the unit for the numbers that you see in this map are called millibars. Millibars are the unit for air pressure. A tool for measuring air pressure is called a barometer. A barometer can be an instrument all in itself, or you could actually build one, which we will show you later. In addition, you can download a barometer app onto your phone, like this one.
So we're going to take this beaker and we're going to stretch a balloon over top of it and make something like a drum. Okay? And then we're going to tape a little piece of tape, a popsicle stick, to our little balloon drum. That doesn't look like much, but if you think about what's going on here, we can see the tip of that popsicle stick. If the air is pushing down on the drum more, it'll go up. And if it were pushing on it less, it would go down, right? So now we have a needle that can measure the air pressure. As the weight of the air increases, our needle will go up. It's an aneroid barometer. Speaking of aneroid barometers, I wanted to share with you this clock that was left to me by my father. This clock, unlike other clocks that need something to wind their spring, uses the changes in air pressure to wind its spring. Every time the air pressure increases, the spring gets wound up, and then the spring keeps the pendulum spinning. That way, this clock never needs wound. It's run continuously for years and years and years without interruption.